Hey, welcome. I hope you all had a good lunch, and I hope I don't bore you too much. I want to talk to you about promises and generators and async await in Node.js. So basically how we do asynchronous coding in Node.js. I myself use Node quite a bit. And Node and JavaScript in general really changed quite a bit over the last couple of years. And those particular patterns I found quite interesting, so I thought I'd share it with you, and hopefully you take something out of this. And the first thing that's important to understand for all those things is how Node works internally with the event loop. And you probably all know Node to some extent. You all know how the Node event loop works? Show of hands. Or never heard about it at all? All right, let's talk about it quickly then. If that thing works, perfect. So in Node, everything goes through this event loop. And we have those different phases in each tick of this event loop. In the first phase, the timers, everything gets executed that's set by timers, set timeout and set interval. And the second phase is the one we care the most about. Most of our custom code in Node gets executed in the second phase, and this I/O callbacks. Whenever we do stuff, we have to keep that in mind, that we are probably right there. Then the third phase is internally used, so we don't really need to care about that too much. But then the next one, the poll phase, is really important as well, because there we do everything else as waiting for new requests and those kind of things. So basically, those are the two most important phases. Either you're executing your custom code, or you're waiting for new requests or similar things. And you can't do both at the same time, so it's single-threaded, so you need to keep that in mind. As long as you're in the second phase, executing your code, you can't take new requests on. And when we talk about asynchronous coding in Node, what we mean is we do something, we offload it, Node gives it to the kernel, we wait for the database to give us a response, or things like that. And while it does that, it just goes on to the next phase and waiting for new requests and takes them on, does something, offload it again to a third-party system, so we can go on and move through our event loop. So we want to look at how we do this asynchronous calls, and the thing that we usually did were callbacks in Node. And you've probably all seen something like this, you've probably written it, and you might even have a keyboard shortcut for it. And the main thing is that you have both the happy pass and the error pass within the same body, essentially. So you check for the error manually. If there was no error, you can go on in your happy pass. So a big issue here is that you have to do the error handling manually at each step in the time. If you forget it, you might end up on a happy pass where you shouldn't be, or you're in a status that you don't quite know. So that's kind of an issue. And so people came up with promises. And since version 0.12, promises are in Node natively, and you can use them. And it would look something like this. So in this example, I just took the read file method from the core API, from the file system core API, and it basically allows you to just, well, read a file from your file system. And you could do something like this, where you take it as a promise, you send on it for your happy pass and catch for the error, error pass. And this already shows quite nicely that the problem we had before in the callback is not quite as much of a problem anymore, because we have a clear separation between our error pass and our happy pass. However, with this example, there's a small issue, and that is it doesn't actually work. It throws an error. And that is because, as of now, the Node Core API does not return promises. So for this read file example, you have to use callbacks. It does not support promises. You can find the full discussion on GitHub, and it's ongoing. I think the last post on there was like yesterday or so. But basically, right now, the main concerns are that, first of all, Node wants to be backwards compatible. So if you just start returning promises instead of callbacks, pretty much every Node application out there will suddenly fail. And the second thing why we don't support both in Node is that, as of now, we want to keep it lightweight. If we have everything twice in there to do the same thing, it's a lot of unnecessary code, really. And this may change in the future, it may not, but just keep in mind, as of now, it is not actually supported for the Node Core APIs. So you can either write your own promises, use libraries that promise by the Node Core API, or just use callbacks, really. But yeah, that's important to keep in mind. But let's just write our own function with a promise. And the first thing you'll notice is the new promise keyword that we have. And that is the main thing. This new promise, well, it returns a promise, of course. But it also takes a function with two parameters, which are by convention called resolve and reject. And as you see, those two things, resolve and reject, are actually callbacks, really. So this whole system still works based on callbacks. And then if you are happy and you want to go down your happy path, you call resolve, and otherwise you call reject. So the whole thing just kind of puts everything from the level we had before in your callback, puts it in the promise itself, so you don't have to worry about it later on anymore. But internally, in your promise, it still works the very same way. So if you look at a better example, say we want this read file from earlier to work with a promise, we could make it work like this. We again just use a new promise keyword, of course, to return a promise. And then we call the read file function from earlier. And within the callback, if there was an error, we can just reject the promise or otherwise resolve it. So what happens here is we still do the same thing. But thanks to the promise, we can have the clear separation between the error path and the happy path. Then, as you can see in the usage, it would work like we saw earlier, and we can go on. For exactly those kind of things, there are libraries that can do it for you if you want to, but it's fairly simple to do it yourself as well, if that's something you want to do. Now, with promises, you can do a few more things. So the main thing that everybody is probably using is chaining and promising. And promises, you can chain them one after another. That was always a big issue with callbacks. And some people had issues with them, called it callback hell or similar. And with promises, that's not an issue anymore, because you just chain them one after another. And then at the end, you can use one catch method to catch all errors that happens there, instead of doing it in every single callback. So whether the first asynchronous action, your first promise, fails, or the second one, it goes to this one catch, and you just catch them all. Because in most use cases, you don't really care which one failed. If one action failed in your transaction, you just want to error handle the whole thing as one. And you can do that with promises. And the other big thing you can do with promises is run them at the same time, essentially. So you just give and promise all an array of promises. It starts all resolving them, or well, rejecting. And then you just, at the end of it, when all of them are finished, you can go on in your happy path or in your error path, which again was a little more complex with callbacks, so it can be helpful in that regard. And the other thing that is not quite as useful, but every now and then it's really good to know about it anyway, is promise race, and as it says, it basically is well, a race condition in the sense that you give it an array of promises, and whichever promise is first resolving or rejecting will get resolved, and the other ones will be ignored. But here, keep in mind, even if the first one rejects and the second one would resolve successfully, your whole race promise rejects. So whatever is first done will be regarded as the one promise. So that's important to keep in mind. Now, since version 4, I think, we've got generators in Node. And generators are a little complex, but basically, they are just functions that you can pause and then later on resume again. Usually, when we are in Node and we have a function, you expect the function to run from the top to the end, and nothing else comes in there. So when we think back about the event loop, where we said just one thing can happen at a time, while you're in this function running from top to bottom, nothing else can happen. You can't take new requests, you can't run any other code. However, generators allow you to basically pause it at some point in your function, jump out, and do other things. So the most basic example for that would just look like this. And the things you notice is the asterisk between function and foo, which basically declares the whole thing as a generator. And the other thing is the keyword yield. And that basically is the point at which you pause your function or jump back in again. To have a better example for that, or how you would use it rather, you get the instance of your generator now. So if we had this full generator, we get an instance of it, and then we call next on it. And next basically continues your generator from the last point where you paused it. The very first time you run it, you obviously run from the very top to the first time you paused it. And the return value in your next is always an object which gives you two properties, which are a value and an indicator whether your generator is finished or not. In this particular case, the value would be bar, obviously, because we said maybe we want to get bar out of this generator. But surprisingly, the finished indicator says false. And that is because when we were to jump back in again, it would run from the yield to the bottom of the function. In this example, there is nothing else. It's a little pointless. However, you have to keep that in mind. It's just finished if it reaches the actual end of the function. So in this case, it would be the bracket, really. Alternatively, you can still use return as you usually would, which will always indicate the generator is finished as well. So generators generally are treated as iterators. And here's a very simple example. And the first thing you probably notice is that we have a while true loop in there, which is something you should never do in JavaScript usually, because, of course, as we said earlier, as long as it runs, nothing else can happen. But in this case, whenever we go loop through it, we can just pause our generator, do something else, and jump back in again later on. So if we were to just take this generator, call next on it, we get out a 0 and then a 1 and so on. But between the times we call it, we can do random other stuff. And the interesting thing we can see is it's quite easy to get data out of a generator. But you can, of course, also put data back into the generator and do stuff with it. So whenever we pause it with the yield keyword, we can give it a value and then use this value further on in our generator. Of course, for the first time we call next, we can't really use it because at this point we start from the top. However, you can give it, of course, a parameter when you create the instance of your generator. So now it's really interesting. We can get data out of it. We can put data into it. And that would mean we could do something like this now, where we say, OK, we want to do this asynchronous function, wait for it to finish, and jump back into our generator. And have it in one line. And obviously, it doesn't just work like this, but if we have a full example within a generator, it could look like this. Say we have an API, and we have our process request, and it does some asynchronous stuff. We could just yield our read file promise. It does this asynchronous action, in this case, well, reads a file. And once it's done, jump back into the generator with the response from this asynchronous call, and we then can use it for whatever we want to use it. Now, the thing you probably notice here is a run wrapper that we have around our generator. And this run wrapper is basically doing all the magic. We wrap the generator in there, and then we can pause it for our asynchronous calls. But as you might notice, I called here the read file promise. And that's important because the whole thing just works with promises. So again, it's based on promises in a similar way how promises need still callbacks. So let's have a look at the run function, what it actually does, because the actual magic happens in there. And it's maybe a little complex, and you don't really need to fully understand it, but it probably helps you if you do. So yeah, you might want to have a look at this later again in a little more detail. But so one really interesting thing is that it, on its own, returns a promise as well. And that's, again, really important, and we'll talk about this a little more later on. So the run function itself is this promise that either resolves or rejects. And as we said earlier, we want to iterate over all those asynchronous calls we have going on in our generator. And for that, we have that little bit of code here, basically a step function, which is just called. And for the first time we pause our generator for the first yield we find, we take this promise, this read file promise, and then wait for it to resolve. Once it resolves, we can jump back into our generator, give it the value that we got from our asynchronous call, and then just go in our generator further until our next promise where we want to stop, wait for the promise to resolve, and jump back into our generator. And of course, we have the error cases here as well, and if there is any error within your generator, we just reject the whole promise as a whole, so your whole generator says, okay, there was an error, we couldn't do that. And of course, just to make the point clear again, we just can do it with promises. If we use this pattern, you can just yield promises and nothing else. So a little more complex example here. Say we want to create a new user on our API, for example. We could do something like this, where we have first check whether the user already exists, makes the asynchronous call to our database, check whether already a user exists with that email. If that's the case, we can just return an error, say, okay, that user already exists, we couldn't create it. Since we use return in this case, the indicator whether the generator has finished is set to true, so we just stop executing here and don't go further down in our generator. Otherwise, we might want to write the user to the database, which again is an asynchronous call. So we want to pause our generator at this point, wait for the database to finish the write request, and then continue on in our generator. And then the next step might be that we want to send an email to our user, which again would be an asynchronous call. So we can use yield again and wait for the asynchronous action to finish before we continue in our generator. So you can do a lot of asynchronous calls, but write your code in a synchronous fashion rather than with promises or callbacks. That would look slightly different. And now the interesting thing is, since the run wrapper itself is a promise on its own, each of those calls we call here could be written in the same manner. So our get user by email function could be wrapped in the run wrapper on its own, and you can use the same pattern. So with this, you can use this very same pattern throughout your whole application, which makes it really powerful. And now since version 7.10, we've got a node async await, which is pretty much the same thing, just we don't need this run wrapper anymore. If you look at the same function we had earlier, the get user by email, you can see the difference is that we replaced the run with an async, and we don't need the asterisk anymore because it's not a generator, it's a native async function. And we replaced the yield keyword with await. Apart from this, it's quite literally the same thing. The async function also returns a promise, the same as our run wrapper. So it's just a nicer way to do it natively, so you don't have to implement it yourself. And now the interesting stuff is, for the error handling that we were talking about earlier, we can use the try-catch block, which you usually can't with asynchronous stuff when you use promises or callbacks. Here you cannot. As we said earlier, if you reject the whole promise if there's an error, usually it would just bubble up and whoever calls this get user by email can deal with it. But if it's an error we expect and we don't want to bubble up, we can use try catch to just do some custom error handling in our catch block, which makes it really powerful. And in the try block, again, you don't have to just use one await call. You can do as many as you want and just catch all of them. So again, we don't have it like we have it with callbacks. Just for every single callback, this error handling, we can just deal with it very simply for as much stuff as we want in one go. So we talked a lot about replacing callbacks and having these patterns that are more powerful than callbacks, but does that mean that callbacks are bad? First off, all these things are highly opinionated. You might like callbacks better than promises, use them. There's not necessarily that promises are better than callbacks. Just some people like them better, other people don't like them as much. In fact, at the very, very early stages of Node, there were promises implemented natively, and they got kicked out in favor of callbacks. It's not that promises are better. It's just, well, some people like them better, some don't. But there are a few things where callbacks are definitely better than promises. Those are events, for example, streams, and generally everything that can be called more than once. Promises, by by nature can just be called once, and the same is obviously true for the async await pattern. So for all those things, keep in mind callbacks are very powerful. It doesn't mean, you know, you have to kick out callbacks out of your application altogether. They have their place, they are useful. Nonetheless, I think promises and async await can really help with your code readability, can help with maintainability, and all those kind of things. And again, as we saw earlier, promises are kind of based on callbacks, and async await is kind of based on promises. So under the hood, what's going on? It's the very same thing. If you have a promise in a catch or then block, it happens at the same exact point in your event loop. So what happens once it's actually running is pretty much the same thing. It's just how your code is, you know, the syntax of your code, how you can maintain it, how easy it is to understand what you're trying to do. Those things are affected. But technically, it's pretty much the same thing. So don't worry about those things too much. Generally, I hope I could inspire you a little to try them out, to use those things. But generally speaking, just try and write some asynchronous code, use those patterns, see if you like them, see if they work for you. As I said, it's pretty much, you know, an opinion whether it's better or not. But I hope you can try them out and enjoy using those cool new features in Node. Thanks. If you do have any questions, please let me know.